Is everyone here this morning, is it good to be a Christian?
Amen.
Just do that one more time. Isn't it good to be a Christian?
Amen.
There were two lights that met on the water, and as they met, one of the guys on the ship got on his radio and said, "You're in our lane, you need to move over to the side." And the other guy communicated back, "No, you need to move over." And this went back and forth several times, and finally the guy on the big ship said, "This is the admiral of this ship, move." And the other guy came over the radio and said, "This is the captain of the lighthouse, you move." There's a difference between boats that can move and lighthouses. Lighthouses are pretty fascinating when you think about them. Providing guidance for people that are out at sea, rescue, safety. You can go, there's actually a lighthouse list that you can look at. If you Google it, you can just look at all the different lighthouses. There's thousands of them in America. I think over 150 in that Michigan area. And they're fascinating to learn about. And when I've traveled places, one year I went up to Maine and rented a car and drove up to the coast of Maine into Canada. And I always like to stop and look at lighthouses and read about the history and things that have happened, because they provide direction for people without it that would run on sandbars or run into cliffs or not know where true safety was. And if you go back in time before lighthouses, there's some fascinating stories, 16, 1700s, how that they set up things to safely guide ships to shore. God provides light for us. We read in Psalm 119, 105, "Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path." God provides light. We also know that He sent Jesus into the world as the light of all men, the true light. God gives us direction. When Jesus was on earth, He taught and He exemplified. He provided light for us. And He wants us to safely navigate through this life. And this life isn't easy. There are obstacles to overcome. There are difficulties to face. Every day we wake up, there are unexpected things that come into our lives. Sometimes we don't know what to do with life. But God provides a way and simply says, "Trust in me with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge me, and I'll direct your steps." God wants to provide that guidance. And Jesus does that for us by establishing some lighthouses. Things that don't move, things that are sure, things that are right, things that are true, things that if we pay attention to, we'll be able to navigate through life in the right way, spiritually. And if we don't, we're going to find ourselves hitting the sandbars, running into the cliffs, dealing with the dangers that keep us from getting to God. And so this morning, I want us to take a look at getting a grip on our priorities, taking three actions that Jesus, sometimes the things that we run into in life is because our priorities aren't straight. We don't have ourselves focused on the right thing, but on the wrong thing. And Jesus says, if you're going to follow me, you got to get your focus. You got to deny yourself, take up your cross daily and follow me. You've got to sit down and count the cost, whether you can do this or not. And you've got to hate your mother, father, brother, sister, in other words, love less. And you've got to sit down like a guy building a building or a person going to war. And in Luke 14, 25 through 33, and verse 33, he says, you've got to know the cost. And the cost is, you've got to give up everything, even your life, to be my disciple. And with that surrender in mind, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual worship. Don't be conformed into the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you will know God's will, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Romans 12, 1 and 2. With that in mind, let's take a look at what Jesus says. First of all, He says you've got to answer the question, where's your treasure? What's important to you? This morning I got up. I run just about every day, but I was running through the neighborhood. And I got close to the house, and I'm walking, and a guy I know real well pulls up beside me and rolls the window down. And, you know, he asked me, you know, what I was doing. He knows I'm a preacher, so he knows I'm fixing to be going to services. And I said, what you up to? And he said, oh, same thing every Sunday. And he's got his dog in the back, and he's going up to the store, and he's going to get his lotto tickets, right? Where's your treasure? What's important to you? We know there's a lot of people that live by the motto they love things and use people, but we know that Jesus has called us to use things and love people. Sometimes you got to know where your treasure is, what drives you. So Jesus says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moss and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moss and vermin do not destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Focus on spiritual things, not physical things. Are physical things okay? Are they important? Yes. And some of it's fascinating. I mean, I think about when I was growing up and I experienced things that these kids don't even, you know, 8-track tapes. And, you know, we've moved a long way. Some of that stuff is cool. But what is my focus on? What drives my life? Is it spiritual or physical? We live in a materialistic world. We live in a materialistic country. We live in a world that's trying to sell us things all the time. And we want more and more and more. And somewhere down the line, we have to get things balanced and get our priorities straight about really what's important. And what the most important thing is our spirituality. Jesus said, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and yet forfeits his soul? What's most important is where you are spiritually. One lays up treasures in heaven by seeking first the kingdom of God. This means you put first God first and obey His commands. We should put our trust in things that will last rather than things that will perish. But does our life reflect that? When someone looks in your life, what looks most important? And is it the spiritual or is it the physical? Jesus says, a lighthouse in your life has to be, and your treasures are in heaven. That's what's most important. It's God first. It's like we said last week. Paul said, I care very little if I'm judged by you or by any human court. I don't even judge myself. The question is not what I think or what others think. It's about what God thinks. Spirituality is about putting God first. I got to thinking to myself the other day, sometimes I will get to thinking in my head, you know what, I really just need to relax, or I need to rest, or I need to do this. And I started thinking, you know what? When I start asking the I questions, when it comes to especially church work, if I start asking the I questions, something's not right. Because the question shouldn't be, I need. The question should be, what does Jesus need? What does God want? Not what do I want for this church? That doesn't matter. What does God want? Jesus sometimes ministered to people so much that he didn't even have time to eat, Scripture tells us. Where's our focus? And if what we do on Sunday morning is what it's all about, then something's not right. The second thing he asked about is, how good is your eyesight? What do you see? This is a verse that's a little bit more confusing, a little hard to understand at first, especially in the King James Bible, because it talks about, it says it in a way that is a little harder to understand. So let's look at this. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Jesus is telling us to be spiritually healthy. And he's using vision to help us see it. This, about a week ago, Kendall and I went to get our eyes checked. And it's always amazing to me, they got a camera that will take pictures of your eye, and then the doctor will look at it with you. And it's to help you see the health of your eye. And there's certain things that need to be light, there's certain things that need to be dark, and they'll explain all that stuff to you. And it's fascinating to me, because I want to know, is my eye healthy or not? I mean, I know I can't see very well when I take these off. These help correct that, but are my eyes healthy? Jesus is saying he wants us to understand the importance, not just about thinking about heavenly things, spiritual things, but being healthy spiritually. You can be here this morning and not be spiritually healthy. You cannot be spiritually healthy and not be here. What's most important is being spiritually healthy. It means that the eye is healthy. It sees things as they are. In the spiritual sense, seeking God first, and you see things correctly between the temporal and the spiritual. The idea is that the affections of the heart affect one's outlook of life. What he's driving at here is, what is our desires? In some translations in your Bible, it will talk about the good eye and the bad eye, or the unhealthy eye and the healthy eye, right? Or the evil eye and the straight eye, the eye that is singular in purpose. And what it drives us to is to understand that he's using an analogy to help us understand that the desires that we have to be centered on God. And when that is healthy, we'll be spiritually healthy. But what does it mean? A single eye. In the King James Version, what it means is to be undivided, to be whole. Is your eye whole or is it divided? Does it have a good part and a bad part? Is it whole? It's what integrity means, right? An undivided heart. That's what Jesus is getting at. A spiritually healthy person has an undivided heart. It's not split between one thing and another. It's whole. Are you whole spiritually? Because if you're not, whatever you withhold from God, he's going to keep on moving in your life to get you to let go. Sometimes it's as simple as asking yourself the question, in my life, is there anything that is controlling me instead of me controlling it? If there is, then you probably got a divided heart. You probably have a spiritual problem that can lead to a hard heart. What kind of heart do you have? And it's not talking about the physical blood pumper. It's talking about the seat of your intellect, your emotions, your will, your spirit. It's about that thing. And so Solomon says in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, above all else, guard your heart. Protect your heart. Be careful what you let in and what you let out. Because if your heart is dark, everything's going to be dark. Can you imagine if the other night in class I had all the teenagers get in groups of three? One person was blindfolded, and the other two people, one got in the front and one got in the back, we put them over here, and the object was to, the person was to lead them over to that chair where Ronnie sits, and back over here without them, you know, falling, bumping into stuff or whatever. So they did that successfully. Then I told all the kids, if you have the blindfold on, come back up here, still blindfolded. Everybody else, stay in the room. And now on your own, retrace your steps. They're blindfolded. They can't see. And they've got to retrace their steps from there to there and back. How successful do you think they were? Chloe was on all fours, trying to find her way. Anna, I think, could see a little through her blindfold. So she made it. But it wasn't easy, right? It was a struggle. Because when you can see clearly, no problem. But when your sight is impaired, you've got a problem. It's more difficult. Jesus is telling us your spiritual health has to be a priority, and you have to make sure your heart is not hard, that your heart is not divided, that you have a singular purpose, that your desires are in the right place. And that's why Jesus will say in the Beatitudes, blessed are the pure in heart. What does that mean? It means your motives are pure. I mean, if you want to give yourself a test for the next week, take a 3x5 card and write on there, what is my motive? And before you make a decision or before you do something, answer that question. You're about to tell your wife something? What's your motive? You're about to do something with your kids? What's your motive? You're about to spend 4 hours watching something on television? Why are you doing what you're doing, and what is your motives? Are your motives pure? Sometimes we need to catch ourselves. That's why Paul says, take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. Do you have an undivided heart? And then he finishes up with something we've already talked about, serving two masters. You can't serve two masters. You're going to be loyal to one or the other. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. So serve God alone. That's what God wants. Let me see what I can't see it over there. Serve and be only devoted to God. God has to be our only priority. God has to be what is most important. And in your life, that's the question. Is God in his proper place? Is he my top priority? Now, you don't see him as much anymore because people have ice makers in their refrigerators. But when I was growing up, we lived in an apartment, and one of my jobs was drying the dishes, and one of my jobs was filling the ice trays. Remember those? And some of those ice trays were the metal ones, you know, that had the little lever, and y'all remember those? And some of them were I remember we got some cool plastic ones, and that was my job. And I used to, a lot of people, you know, they would fill each deal. Sometimes I would fill one and let it flow. I like to watch it, you know. But, okay. Anyway, some of us treat our spirituality like an ashtray. We compartmentalize the things in our life. We have a place for money. It's in one little pew. We have a place for our recreational activities. We have a place for our family. We have a place for church. We have a place, and we compartmentalize our spirituality. And it makes it real easy for us to be really good at church and then kind of do what we want to over here, because they really don't flow together. But what's interesting, those little curves they put in the ashtrays, if you think about it, when you fill one up, the first one up, it'll flow into all the others. And really, that's the picture Jesus is trying to get us to think about here. Your treasures are in heaven. Your eyes are healthy. You're serving the right master. Just like Joshua said, for me and my family, we're going to serve the Lord. You've made that commitment. You've made that choice for yourself. Once you fill up that first pew, you can leave it there and it'll flow into all the others. Jesus wants you to put Him first and let Him flow into all the others. Because in the next verses, He's going to say, don't worry about what you're going to wear or what you're going to eat. God takes care of all that. Seek first My kingdom and My righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you as well. Get things in a proper place. In our lives, we constantly come to a crossroads, and we have to make a choice. Are we going to have healthy sight or unhealthy sight? Are we going to lay for ourselves treasures in heaven? Is it going to be spiritual or is it going to be physical? We make those choices. Make the choice to put God first. Make the choice that takes care of your soul. Because Jesus said, what does it profit you if you gain the whole world and yet you forfeit your soul? Some of us need to relook at our priorities because they're not in the right place. Jesus said, if you want a lighthouse to help you maneuver through life when you don't know how to make it clearly through, here's some principles. Here's some lighthouses that help you get the right focus. Maybe you need to take that first step in becoming a Christian today by being baptized. Maybe you need to rededicate your life to Christ. Whatever you need, please come as we stand and sing.